Hi there. In the previous video, I've shown you how to create a responsive project, manage breakpoints and layouts, and animate in the base layout. In this video, I'll show you how to override properties and animations in each layout. By doing so, you can create different sets of styles which fit different layouts. Now, I'm in the base layout where element properties and animations are applied to all responsive layouts. To choose a layout to edit, I use the responsive toolbar or the breakpoints pane. First, take a look at the layout larger than 1200 pixels. Click Adjust Container Size on the responsive toolbar to resize the container. That way, you can see how the output document will look across different container sizes. This layout looks perfect, so I won't make any changes to it. When I scale the container down, I enter the layout between 900 pixels and 1200 pixels. The page title seems too big, so I will scale it down. As you can see, the size property is marked orange when I make a change to it. It now no longer inherits from the base layout. So if I go back to the base layout and change the text size in this layout will remain intact. As I click a highlighted property, I can remove property override. You can see that the layout is altered at the breakpoint when the container size changes. Let's move on to the next layout between 600 pixels and 900 pixels. This layout is meant for tablet portrait, so I'll change the side navigation bar to a top one. I'll also scale the page title down so that it fits the new viewport width. The top navigation bar should take up the entire scene width, so its width is 100%. Meanwhile, its height is absolute, not relative to the scene height anymore. I'll do the same to the navigation menu. Now, I'm going to make the buttons relative to the menu so that they are also relative to the scene. The five buttons should be equal in dimensions, and together take up 100% of the menu. So each button takes up 20% of the menu width. I'll position the buttons relative to the left corner of the menu. Now that the top navigation bar looks all right, I'll restyle the page title. The text should be smaller and appear right in the center, so I set the text indentation to 0 pixel. You must still remember why early on I had to set the indentation to 110 pixels. That's because initially, the side navigation bar takes up 110 pixels of the scene width. Alright, now move on to the smallest layout where the navigation bar collapses to a hamburger menu. Similar to the layout between 600 pixels and 900 pixels. In this layout, the navigation background takes up the entire scene width. The hamburger icons should now appear, so I change the display value to on. In the previous video, initially I made these icons invisible, because they don't need to be seen in the base layout and others, but in this smallest layout. Now, as I change the display value of the icons, you can see the icons and the display property are highlighted in the timeline pane. As I click the icons or properties, I can remove animation override, just as removing property override in the properties pane. I'm going to stack the icons, and pin them to the top right corner of the scene so that they maintain the distance to that corner. The navigation buttons should take up the entire scene width. So, I set the menu width and the width of menu buttons to 100%. Now, I'll rearrange the buttons. This is how the buttons will appear when the menu is opened. Initially, the menu closes and you cannot see the buttons. In Saola Animate, there is more than one way to make elements invisible. But as I want to create a slide effect when clicking the hamburger button, I'll set the overflow of the menu to hidden, and set its height to 0 pixel. The buttons now disappear. Now, I'm going to create a timeline. Let's call it navigation. I'll animate the height of the menu in this timeline. Alright. It's time to make the hamburger button work. Initially, when the button is clicked, the menu slides down and the button gets darker. So, the actions include starting the navigation timeline, and hiding the upper icon. Let's preview. This is the slide down effect. Now move on to the slide up. When the lower icon is clicked, the navigation timeline will start in backward direction, and the upper icon is shown again. Let's see if the button works as expected. It's perfect, except one thing. The button should use a pointer cursor. Okay. The last thing to do now is restyle the page title. That's all I wanted to say about overriding properties and animations in responsive layout. Thank you for watching.